Inside the Music with saxophonist Will Donato and co-host Jack Cohen. We bring you renowned recording artists and musical guests from around the globe, featuring live in-studio performances from our very special guests. We broadcast live from the LA Talk Radio studios the first and third Saturdays of each month in stunning HD video. Thank you for tuning in to Inside the Music.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Inside the Music with Will and Jack. Today, Will is the beautiful Cheryl Aronson.
Thank you, Jack.
I'm so glad to see her in front of the camera.
Cheryl did us a huge favor, and it's an honor to have the people we have here today. It's all because of Cheryl Aronson. And we had the legendary Latin jazz Pete Escovedo here.
Nice to be here. Good
yeah, morning. And we had the legendary trumpeter Ranger Greg Adams.
Yay!
Yeah, so I'm like a kid at candy store. Show.
Me too. I am
yeah.
too. I'm
yeah. So,
so
the reason why, and we have Daryl Fitzgerald Walker,
of
one of the
course.
Best singers you could possibly ever run across,
and get that
other than Pete Escovedo.
And of course, yeah. we have Mr. Chuck Dennis.
Yeah, we
who
do.
Is the founder and promoter of the Oxnard Jazz
Festival.
So what we're doing, thanks to Chuck and Cheryl, is we're having our first, and hopefully we can first annual, maybe we'll do it again.
Yeah.
We're featuring a jazz festival. So before we get into the show, Cheryl, I wanted to talk about, we just were at the San Diego Jazz Festival.
We were at the San Diego Jazz Festival. It was an amazing 2 days of music.
Yes, it was a beautiful setting right on the water. Cheryl and I were talking about this on the way up. You know, there's a lot of talk about the demise of jazz, smooth jazz.
No.
And really, you know, like in the last couple of years, Chuck, you started your
yes.
festival.
Correct.
And
correct.
It's been going up and up,
yes.
the Oxnard Jazz
Third
Festival.
Third year now. Third
yeah.
year.
San Diego Jazz Festival has so done 2 years in a beautiful, beautiful setting right on the bay in San Diego, the view in downtown. The audiences are huge. They're enthusiastic. It's amazing. Cancun Jazz Festival has been very
Beach.
Successful
very
the last 3 years.
Is yep. Long Beach is 30 years.
So what
years
I'm saying, long. There's a lot of room for enthusiasm in the genre. You know, people can talk about this, talk about that. No radio stations, but people are passionate about the music and they turn out.
They turn out.
And they like it live.
And they want yeah. the musicians to sign the CDs, which
right.
they still buy. So
yeah.
we love that, too.
Yeah, which is great, too.
Yeah.
So today's show is going to be about the Oxnard Jazz mm-hmm. Festival. We have the promoter and founder, Chuck Dennis, here.
Hello.
And Chuck's going to give us, in a couple minutes, Chuck's going to give us a little preview of what you might see about starting the festival and all that. And Greg and East Bay Soul is one of his headliners.
Yes.
And Pete. And the Pete Escovedo Band is the other headliner, right?
Yeah.
Plus Mindy Hebert as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So many wonderful acts. We'll talk all about that. Yes.
Yeah. So what's the dates of the festival?
It'll be September 8th. However, that's the music day, all day music, but on Friday, and we'll ask Chuck to talk about the whole weekend. There's going to be lots of activity the whole weekend.
Okay. Yeah, we're really looking forward to that. I haven't yes. been there, but I hear it's a gorgeous setting.
It's wonderful. Okay, well, I'm going to introduce myself. I'm Cheryl Aronson. Thank you so much for letting me co-host the show today. I am the publicist for the Oxnard Jazz Festival, and you all know me as a journalist. I write for Agenda Magazine, The Hollywood 360, and I also want to say I just authored my first book, which is called Passing Myself Down to the Grave. So to start off today, we are going to interview Chuck Dennis. I have to say, I have had the pleasure of knowing this gentleman for a full year. I went to the Oxnard Jazz Festival last year, was my first time, and I so enjoyed myself. It is a community-spirited festival. The community of Oxnard is awesome. It is beautiful. It's by the beach. Chuck has picked out a fabulous location. There are hotels that will give you discounts. It's just going to be a great weekend. So, Chuck, let's start off and talk about what was your vision to start the Oxnard Jazz Festival?
Well, the vision was based on the Strawberry Festival and the Salsa Festival that there were really no real festivals that really catered to full bands where, you know, they're celebrities. You know, usually they were just like every now and then you might get a celebrity. We wanted to have a celebrity star-studded stage coming to the city of Oxnard on the beach, something that is unheard of in the county. And it's our third year, and we are knocking it out of the park.
Yes, you are. I mean, it's getting bigger and bigger every year.
Yes.
Absolutely,
yes.
Right? Talk a little bit about the community of Oxnard and tell everybody how fabulous it is.
Well, we're a small community. We're sitting on the beach. It's really an unheard of area. I mean, people, you say the word Oxnard, they're like, where's Oxnard? I never heard of Oxnard. So what we wanted to do was to create a vision for people, you know, offer hotels, you know, we're right on the beach. I mean, it's relatively a small market. I mean, I think it's 1 million people in the Ventura County area, but, you know, we just decided to bring something to the community where we can actually party.
Absolutely, and this festival is like Long Beach, like San Diego. You're gonna have vendors, you're gonna have food, you have VIP. Tell everybody about all the different aspects of the Oxnard Jazz Festival.
Well, as Cheryl just stated, I mean, we're pretty much like all the other festivals with the VIP section, our cabanas, and then we have our regular lawn seating. But what kind of sets us apart just a tad bit is we like to party. We're going to make sure that it's an upbeat, everything is upbeat. There's no dead time between the DJs we selected and between the activities we're going to have. It's just going to be a party, you know.
I got to tell you, looking at your lineup,
yeah.
I'm pretty sure with these two guys, it's going to be a party.
Be a party.
You're talking about here two big band yeah. sounds. I love it.
Yeah.
You know, where do you see big band sounds in festivals?
You don't hardly see it.
You know what? I really admire the lineup that you put together there. Because I'm looking at it, I'm thinking like, wow, I could really enjoy myself there listening to two big bands like this, Mindy Hebert,
yes.
you know, and Confunction. Your whole lineup is
yes.
spectacular.
Yes.
A fun lineup.
Yes, and we kind of I handpicked that based on the demographics we have in the community. So what I tried to do was cover a little bit of everybody. So we got, you know, just R&B, a little Latin,
great
little
choices.
Jazz, and it works for the community. And the city of Oxnard is behind us 120%.
I have to say, again, Chuck is correct. Everybody is up and dancing. And you cannot not dance to Pete Escovedo's music and Greg Adams' space. So,
yes.
I mean, it's like, that's all you can do.
Pete, do you let people dance to your music?
Yeah, sure. Whatever they want to do. As long as they keep it clean.
That's right.
Okay.
Okay.
Right.
So, anything else you want to tell us about the Oxnard Jazz Festival? Why do you feel like, you know, you have a special place in the festival lineup this summer? Well, first of all, it's after a lot of the festivals
yes.
are over.
So when I designed it, in 2014, I went to every festival for the year. So I decided to design ours after everyone else was done. And that's why we kind of set ourselves apart, because everybody's done, okay, now you can come to the party.
Yes. It's after you've done the San Diego,
the Long Beach,
and
we love all festivals. We
yes.
all we love all festivals, but ours is just more of a party, and you'll see the atmosphere. I mean, people are not saying anybody else's festivals, but ours is just really a party, a great atmosphere, and everybody is pleasant from
absolutely.
The time you check in to the time you use the restroom.
Well, guess what, everybody? First of all, I'm going to hold this up. This is a lineup of our Oxnard Jazz Festival. And I also have, two pairs of, I dropped one of them.
Now we only have one pair.
I have
the cleanup crew has the other pair.
We will promise you another one, but we are going to have, so keep watching, because we are going to give away the first pair of tickets in a little bit after we begin our interview. With
so those of you in the Facebook live feed,
yes.
We're going to have a contest.
It's going to be a question, so you have to listen in to what these people are saying. You have to stay.
Cheryl, I'm going to interrupt you for a second because we have a quick call in here.
Oh, yes, okay.
Hello, caller, what's your name? Where are you calling from?
Oh, I'm calling from Los Angeles. Jack, this is Niels. How are you?
Hey, Niels. How are you, buddy?
Niels is on the phone.
I'm doing excellent.
Well, what's up, Niels? What's going on?
Well, I just want to let everybody know we're going to play tomorrow. We're doing a CD release concert in San Diego. So for all our San Diego fans that are listening, I want to let them know to come down to the Mediterranean Jazz and Supper Club tomorrow at 8 p.m. And we've got an exciting special guest. We've got Jeff Ryan, who just recently hit number one on Billboard. He's going to open up for us, and he's going to sit in with the band. So it's going to be a lot of fun.
Hey, Niels.
So, Chuck, you're coming down, aren't you?
Yes, I will be there, front row.
So, everybody in San Diego tomorrow night, the doors open at 6 o'clock. Yeah, speaking of party, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so everybody come down. Jeff Ryan, 3 weeks on Billboard number one as a saxophonist, is opening up for Niels, and we're all expecting that to be a party. For tickets, everybody, go to www.whatsupdago.com. Dago is D-A-Y-G-O. Whatsupdago.com. And there's going to be a party in San Diego tomorrow night.
Yay.
Everybody come out and see Niels and Jeff Ryan. Hey, what are we going to see, Niels? What are we going to see when people come out? What are they going to see?
Well, we're gonna play a lot of the new material from the new CD that we just released, Play. And we're moving up on Billboard nicely, too. We were just number three on the album charts last week, and so I'm going to present the new album. I'm going to have new records to autograph and to sell, so bring your jukebox money. and obviously we're playing the big hits, Pacific Coast Highway, Summer Nights, Jumpstart, all the number one hits that we had. So and it's going to be my usual gang. We had Daryl Williams on bass, Tony Moore on drums.
Wow.
Claudine Jackson going to sing, and play keyboards, and Oliver Brown from Casey and Sunshine Band playing percussion. So it's going to be a killer hit.
Niels, thanks so much for calling in, and we'll see you tomorrow night. So everybody, for tickets.
Thank you always. Yeah. Thank you guys for all the support, and my love to your listeners, and I'll see you guys at the show.
Okay. That's whatsupdago.com, Niels and Jeff Ryan. Okay, show back.
You know
back
what?
To
yes. So we were talking about the Oxnard Jazz Festival. I want to tell you where you can get your tickets to see these fabulous
Very
bands.
Important.
So go to www.oxnardjazzfestival.com. Lawn seats are definitely available. Do you have more VIPs?
I think about 37 left.
Okay, so VIP is also a fabulous thing to do, where you get up close and you.
What's that experience like, Chuck? What does a VIP person get?
It's amazing. I mean, it's right in front of the music. I mean, and then you can dance to the side of the stage. We kind of moved it because people were dancing in front, but you.
I'm glad you're one promoter that realized that. I bought a lot of VIP tickets. Yeah, I'm looking at people's rear ends dancing. Not that they didn't look good.
Yeah,
they did look good, but
you can't dance in front of the stage.
Yeah, they're blocking
the section to the right.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah,
so, great idea.
Okay. Yes. Absolutely.
Yes.
And we're going to then backstage is going to be a fabulous thing going on too.
Yes, we're going to cater it backstage with our new company. So it's going to be some amazing food back there as well.
Very exciting. Okay, so listen in at around 10:30 or so. We're going to have a contest. It is going to be a question about Mr. Greg Adams. So if you answer that question correctly, you will win a pair of tickets.
The answer is false.
Sorry. Okay, so just to reiterate, Mikey Cohen is our social media concierge. We made up that title for him.
Speaking of which, right now Will Donato is watching.
Hi, Will.
Okay, so
where's Will?
So for you that are tuning in via Facebook Live, you can chime in, and Mike will answer you, and we will ask the question on air, and then you go to facebook.com/LA Talk Radio, and you should be there already if you're seeing this, and put your answer in, and the first one to have the correct answer will win a pair of tickets to the Oxnard Jazz. That's both at 10:30 and at 11:30. So you want to tune in to the whole show.
They'll win a pair of lawn seats, correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
Lawn seats, absolutely.
And the only thing is, if they're not ready to party, Chuck, is it okay?
No. I don't know.
No. Don't come to Oxnard. Then
they'll go to the next.
Yeah. If they're not ready to party,
it's not.
Have to think about that.
Yeah, we might have to confiscate those tickets.
Yes.
Okay, so shall we begin?
You got to have a party attitude if you go to a show like that.
Absolutely. We have to, definitely. Uh-oh. Somebody's calling?
No, not yet.
Okay.
Okay, so let's go on to Mr. Greg Adams.
Absolutely.
And Daryl Walker.
Absolutely. So we are so happy to have both of these gentlemen here today. East Bay Soul, mm-hmm. one of my favorite groups, big band sound. But Greg, we're going to start talking just a little bit about your background, because it's going to involve the answer to one of these questions. Tell us. You are from the Bay Area, of course,
yes.
and tell us a little bit about your history and how you started out. I know a little bit of the story. You were on your way to Berklee College of Music
right.
and never made it there.
No, I didn't. I was a professional musician at the age of 16, but I was still in high school. But I played in local bands here and there, and I was kind of trying to find my way, and we had a really good jazz band in my high school, and I was arranging for it in my sophomore, junior, and senior years, so I was kind of cutting my teeth on writing and arranging. And there was this band called Tower Power, and they were playing the bars around the Bay Area, and I was playing... You know Pete.
Right?
That's right, man.
Did you guys ever?
Oh, absolutely. Our paths crossed for the last 50 years. Yeah. Really.
Any great Greg and Pete stories?
Or? I don't really think that much so, but, you know, we were always kind of in the, yeah,
right.
It was a scene, you know. It was a beautiful thing in the 70s in the San Francisco Bay Area. And Tower of Power was a band from Oakland. I lived in San Francisco. And it was kind of funny because there was always this thing about San Francisco and Oakland.
Right.
You know, and it was like, you know.
The A's and the Giants, the 49ers,
and
the Raiders.
Raiders. Yeah, and so, yeah. You know, and now, I mean, it's like, you know, Oakland's the new Brooklyn, you know. I mean,
I've heard that.
So I knew these guys, Doc and Mimi and Rocco and Mick, and rest in peace, Mick. And, you know, we'd play clubs, the two bands. I played with a band called, Sweet Linda Devine. It was Linda Tillery, who was a singer with the Loading Zone.
Yeah, Linda,
And so hey, how you doing, Doc? Hi, I'm Mimi. Hi, Greg. Small talk, and then literally I was staying at a friend's apartment in San Francisco getting ready to go to Boston, to go to Berklee, and he was kind of managing Tower of Power in the interim while the real manager was on vacation. So the phone rang, and he said that I'm staying there, and he said, hey, well, you know, put Greg on the line. Short story. I went over to play an audition, I guess, but it really wasn't an audition because they needed me. And they used to be a band called the Motowns, and they had just turned into Tower Power. And so I played with them. They asked me to join the band. We finished up East Bay Grease, which was the band's first record. And then from there, it was 25 years later. I was in 95, I left the band started my own solo career with Epic Records and had a big hit with Sade's Smooth Operator, and it was number one for 5 weeks. And so there I was on my new pattern, my new career, which I really didn't. When I left Tower Power, I didn't know what I was going to do. I thought I'd be a studio rat because I did a lot of session work.
Yeah, I think I noticed on your bio it said you're on 900 recordings. Is that right?
Yeah, I've done about that much.
You know, that's pretty crazy. Yeah. Who are some of the people you recorded on their albums? It's a huge list, right?
says, who haven't I?
Santana, Eurythmics, Dionne Warwick, Celine Dion.
Yeah, that's a who's who in the music scene.
I mean, it runs the gamut, you know. Yeah. I mean, from A to Z. And I've worked with a group in Japan called Dreams Come True for like the last 25 years, and they have been a great source of travel, and really it's been a great. I've been to Japan so many times, but when you go to Japan as an American rock group, you see only one aspect of that. You kind of go all the tourista places, but when you go to Japan with a Japanese group, you see parts of the culture you'd never see that kind of stuff.
How fascinating!
Yeah, it really is great. But you know, I've worked with so many people.
Right.
I forget. I'm doing a session with them next week or next month.
Oh, nice.
Well, Greg, you also played. You got to play with Tower of Power right at the Hollywood Bowl for their 50th year. So you kind of had a little reunion there.
Yeah, that's true. And they did a thing the week before up in Oakland, and I couldn't make that, so they asked me to join them. And so it was fun. It was good.
Excellent.
It's kind of funny. I got to tell you, when we were young, we would talk about backstage. Who was that girl you were with last night? How many joints did you smoke last night? Who paid the bar tab last night in the hotel? And we were sitting. I was sitting down talking with Emilio and Doc, and we were comparing hernias. and Doc was saying, What? What'd you say? And it was kind of funny because through the ages, it's kind of like the subject.
Sounds like me and my friends.
Yeah, it was like funny. It was funny. We were laughing about it. But we had a great time, and it was a great crowd at the bowl. And I always love playing the bowl. It's a little bit funny. Because it's so big and it's just it's an iconic venue.
It is.
And
I
played there for the first time in 1993. God bless you.
Bless you.
with Tower of Power. That was the first time we played the Playboy Jazz. And, that was in the day of, not digital photography.
Right.
And I had a picture taken on. One side of me was Dizzy Gillespie, and on the other side was Wynton Marsalis.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And I'd never met either of them, but they knew who I was, and of course I knew who they were. And, the guy, snapshot, and the photographer moves on, and where's that picture?
I want
that picture.
Could you ever find it or no?
No, never. Oh. Never saw it.
So who, in Tower of Power, who are some of the people we would know that have been through that band over the years that you played with? Some people that are well known now.
Well, Lenny Pickett. Excuse me, I've got my morning thrush. Lenny Pickett is the tenor saxophone player who played with the band for several years. Is now the band director on the Saturday Night Live.
Oh, wow.
And he was at the reunion in Oakland for... And Chester Thompson, who played organ with the band, he went on to play with Santana for several years and co-produced the big record for Carlos. Mm-hmm. And, there's been so many people,
Wasn't Richard Elliott in there?
Oh, that's right. As a matter of fact, I just saw Richard last night. We went up to Thousand Oaks.
Oh, yeah, for the Summer Horns.
Yeah, which I've done both those records. It's the Summer Horns 1 and 2.
Oh,
did you do some arranging on
Yeah, I did several songs on that. And Gordon Goodwin did some, and Tom Scott did some.
The arrangements are incredible.
Oh, thank you.
Really? Yeah.
And so it was kind of funny because Dave, yesterday morning, he says, I know this is embarrassing.
Dave being Dave Cause.
Oh, yeah.
Dave, to
yeah, he said, I know this is a text. He says, I know this is an embarrassingly late notice, but would you like to come to the show tonight? And I said, Andrea, I said, you want to go? She said, well, okay, let's go. So we went up, and it was 116 degrees here yesterday.
That was in Thousand Oaks, right?
Well, in Tarzana, where we live.
Oh, yeah.
So we went up, and... the band sounded great. The horn sounded great. You know, it's a little bit different now. They've got a trombone player named Aubrey Logan.
Oh, we love Aubrey.
She's been on the show like three times.
Yeah, and she's a great singer, too.
Yeah, she is.
And she does one-handed cartwheels.
She does.
Yes.
We
saw
I have
that.
Photos.
We saw that. We couldn't believe that.
She did it last night, like five of them in a row.
What a personality, right?
Yeah, she's a knucklehead.
She's a graduate of Berklee College of Music.
And a great singer.
Yeah.
She did Route 66.
Yeah,
that was just...
I have a video of that.
And she did... She's driving like she scats.
She's driving like her and her husband came across to move to California or something.
Yeah, it was great. And anyway, we saw Richard, you know, and I guess they're flying up to San Jose tomorrow. And you know, Richard is a pilot. And so he and Dave are flying up today to the gig. And Richard used to fly the horn section around when we were playing with Huey Lewis and the News.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
so and you and Richard were playing with Huey Lewis?
Yeah. We were
extending the show till 2 p.m. because there's no way to get all with these two guys.
It's amazing. Greg's career goes deep, very deep.
One time we played with Huey at the Calaveras County. You know, it's up in the Sierras, in Angels Camp. It was a big festival there. I don't know if it still goes on, but we flew up to Stockton, and we had another pilot for that run because Richard had built an airplane, and flew his experimental airplane up to, by himself. You know, up to, and then we took spins around the. it was like you know. Like,
when was this, Greg?
Oh, I don't know. It's 80s, late 80s.
Oh yeah, 90s. I didn't know. His piloting went back that far. Wow.
Yeah, yeah. It was great. I mean, it was a little. Some of the guys were a little skeptical, but we always got there. You know, we got home safe and sound, and you know, but anyway, getting back to last night, it was great to see all those guys.
Nice.
And Aubrey is the trombonist. It used to be four saxes. Now it's Gerald and Richard and Dave and Aubrey and Rick Braun.
And
Rick produced that record, the Summer Horns. Mm-hmm.
Were you Grammy nominated for the previous Summer Horns album? Were you part of that too or no?
No.
Paul Brown. Yeah.
Even though you did the arrangement, you know.
Greg is Grammy nominated and Emmy nominated. But for maybe your other work.
Yeah, well, it was a Tower of Power direct-to-disc album, and it was for the arrangement for What is Hip.
Oh, yeah.
And then
that was the Grammy nomination?
Yeah, and then the Emmy was Paul Schaefer and I David Letterman's.
You guys, East Bay Soul, do What is Hip as well, too, right?
No. We don't do any Tower of Power songs.
Oh, yeah. I thought you guys did What is Hip.
No. It's all original or covers that you've decided. Yeah. Well, I want to go talk about the Oxnard Jazz Festival for a moment, since that's why we're here today. And Greg, I have interviewed you before, and you see you have a little bit of history about Oxnard. Tell everybody, you know, just your own impression of Oxnard, what you think about it.
Well, you know, I don't know that much about Oxnard, but I know that it's like, and I don't mean, I want this to have the meaning of really, it's kind of a, how do you say it, an inside story or something.
Bedroom community?
It's like, how can I say this without being condescending? Because I don't want to be condescending. Mm-hmm. But it's Malibu without the boo.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's gorgeous. It's so beautiful there.
It's beautiful. And, you know, we've been up there. It's been a while. And I think that people just, they drive by and they keep going to Santa Barbara, but you really got to get off the freeway and go to the beach because it's a beautiful place to hang.
It absolutely is.
Years ago, I can't remember, when I was at Tower Power, we played the Strawberry Festival. And it was a great, I remember, it stands out, it was just like a great day, you know, and it's a great community.
It is.
And so we're looking forward to it. You know, it's like so next door to L.A.,
absolutely.
So it's close. I mean, it's a 40-minute drive.
That's it.
You know, and
exactly.
So it's we're looking forward to it.
Okay. Greg and Daryl, for our audience that do not know necessarily East Bay Soul, what can they expect to see coming out to the Oxnard Jazz Festival and watching East Bay Soul.
Great question.
Like, what is, tell them what the music is like and the band and all that.
Wow, that's a tough one to describe. I would just simply say that you're going to get some amazing instrumental and some amazing vocal. I'm not.
No, it's amazing vocals.
No,
I'll say it's
just, I will say amazing. So amazing.
Yeah, beyond amazing.
I just want to say that it's going to be a really great representation of what Greg started all those years ago in terms of the style and the signature. Yet we do our own thing, and the synergy between the musicians is amazing because we actually like each other. So everyone gets along well. Everyone's respectful of the other, and it's just I wouldn't be here 10 years later if it wasn't.
Okay, so in the band, how many pieces do you guys have?
It's 9-piece now, and we. It's kind of funny. We just finished a run up in Seattle at Jazz Alley last week. We did two nights. And we kind of, it's our tradition to be up there around July 4th. They're dark on July 4th because all of Seattle is out on their boats or their barbecuing or their, it's just, they don't even.
My son was out there on a boat on July 4th, actually.
So we played up there on Monday and Tuesday, which are definitely the dark nights of nightclubs. And they're closed on Monday.
Yeah.
And Tuesday is like when they have the amateur hour, you know. But we killed it on Monday and Tuesday, and then the 4th was Wednesday. So the band is like running on all cylinders.
Okay, so the this is a vision back to the days of big band, you know, having a big band. You've got, what, a baritone sax, tenor sax, two trumpets. One is Lee Thornburg, who was also in Tower of Power.
Yes.
And Greg Adams, of course, legendary, both.
Greg
Vale. And Greg Vale when he's available.
You know, it's kind of funny. I just will interject this because, you know, people, it's a revolving door in a big band. And people, the caliber of people that we have in the band is so high
and is
so in demand that now Lee, He's been playing with Joe Bonamassa for the last 3 or 4 years, so we have a new trumpet player.
Oh, you do?
His name is Michael Stevens.
Oh, I know him. He tours with Brian Culbertson.
And then Greg Vale just recently, excuse me, has moved on to play with Luis Miguel.
Yeah,
and so we have a new tenor saxophone player named Steve Nieves, who's played Olivia and...
And Daryl plays sax.
Daryl plays sax. Yeah. So we have a 5-piece horn section when Daryl's not singing.
Yeah.
And it's a killer band.
It's magical.
Hey,
it
we
really
have
is.
Keita on
guitar.
Okay,
Cheryl, I'm going to interrupt you now because it's past 10:30.
Oh, we have.
And people who are tuning in are going to be excited to win these tickets.
Okay.
So we've been talking about the Oxnard Jazz Festival. Now is your chance to get a chance to go there. For free.
That's
two tickets.
Two tickets.
Okay, so
we have a lot of celebrities
in the room. So Greg Adams has been talking about a legendary band that he was in previous to East Bay Soul quite a bit. So what is the name of the legendary band? If you have to go to Facebook Live and roll it back a little bit and see.
Grand Funk Railroad.
The first person.
Grand Funk Railroad.
It's not, by the way, it's not Grand Funk Railroad.
No.
So,
two pair of tickets are waiting
for you. So on Facebook Live, give the answer, and then you will win those two tickets. The next giveaway will be at 11:30.
You finished the question.
Who did?
So what is the name of the original band?
Yeah, what's the name of the original band that, well, he was in a bunch of bands.
What is the first?
The iconic band that Greg Adams was in, the Bay Area band with all the horns that we've been talking about for the last half hour.
Well, no, that's pretty, you know.
Well, hey, we're trying to make it easy for everybody.
It's also, to rule it out, it's not the Pete Escovedo band.
No, it's not. Okay, so Mikey is, so please put your answer into our social media, Mikey Adam Cohen, and you will have.
And then to go there, it's you should be watching it that way, but facebook.com/LA Talk Radio.
Right, and we will announce the winner.
Okay, Cheryl, I think, you know, we've been talking.
Oh, we have a winner. Who is it?
Well, we have two. We have Ashlyn Biscuit Cole. No. And Pam, it's going to go to Pam Ubern. Ubern?
Yes.
Yeah, Pam, it's going to go to you. Thank you
Yay.
So much for watching.
And make sure you give Mikey your email.
And by the way, big hello to Pam and Alan, who are big jazz supporters.
Oh, wonderful.
They go to all That's the great. Festivals. I couldn't think of a more worthy couple to win and enthusiastic. And Chuck, they party.
Good.
They do. They know how to party.
And they dance.
Good.
I'm telling you, I've seen it. Okay, so we're in good shape on that, Cheryl.
Yes.
I think it's time that we play a tune, you know, from East Bay Soul. So
from their new CD.
Yeah, it's off their new CD.
Conversation.
Yes. So, Greg, you want to set up possibilities?
Sure. this song was Nick Milo, our keyboard player, I also played in Tower Power with, and was music director for the late Joe Cocker for 13 years.
Oh, wow.
And then when Joe passed, Nick was, after a couple of years of soul searching, because he was so close to Joe. I mean, he would go to Joe's ranch in Colorado. They'd kick stuff around and play and sing together. And our former keyboardist was suddenly unavailable. And
that was Joey Navarro?
Yeah. Yep. And Nick was available, and Nick was going to sub for Joey on a couple of gigs, and all of a sudden, I said, "Hey, Nick, would you like to join?" Yes.
Let me think about a yes.
Yeah. So, to tell you the truth, the musicality of the band just lifted like that.
Well, aren't you guys co-writers on a lot of tunes too?
Most of them
have been for a long time.
Many years. We've written together for 30 years, and so this one, Nick and I wrote. It was, we wrote the song. And then we didn't have a title, and when you don't have a title, you say M1 or M2 or M3, and M for music, and that's like a film thing.
That's a name.
Scoring.
That's a Jeopardy name. Three tables at Spaghettini in the front. M1
and so,
M2.
So this was
what
M-
is M1
this M2 was
and M3?
M1, wasn't it? I think it was M1 or M2. So anyway, we came up with the title Possibilities, and it's got a funky little beat to
it. Did Andrea make up that title? Or?
Actually, she did.
Let's
come
give
up
a
with
shout
that.
Out to Andrea.
Andrea,
yeah.
Andrea yes. came up with that title. So, anyway, Possibilities.
Okay, so here we go, everybody. Possibilities from the new Conversation CD. And Greg, I got to tell you, your songwriting is spectacular. A lot of times in the jazz genre, melody gets forgotten. And your melodies are spectacular.
Mm-hmm. Oh, thank
They're
you.
Really, really good.
Thank you.
Gotta love your melodies.
Yeah. Really I know the secret. I know the secret. Less is more.
That's always.
Well, let's talk about that after we hear the song. Here we go. We'll be right back.
Okay.
Funky.
I love it. It's so Greg
that's
Adams.
Oakland, yeah.
So sophisticated.
That's Oakland. That's Oakland all
no,
the way.
No, it's Oakland. The
Amen. That's Oakland, baby.
Say more about that, Pete. Why
Come
do you
on. That's Oakland stuff.
Yeah, you hear it, huh?
Heck yeah.
Oh, wow. I love that. That's interesting.
Let's go back to what we were talking about before. Let's delve into the less is more. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us what that concept
well,
is?
Well, you know... Music is a language, just like French or Spanish or Italian and or English, you know, and you learn how to speak a language. And, you know, I think with, and jazz is so improvisational
yes.
that, you know, it's a conversation. And, you know, when you're a young buck and you got a lot to say, even if it's spoken word or it's music. You know, a young guy will play a lot of notes. Mm-hmm. You know, right? Mm-hmm. And I've found, and I'm sure you agree with me, Pete, that as we've gotten older, you try to say more with less words, mm-hmm. you know.
And less is better.
That's right. Less mm-hmm. is more, you know. And so that's the art of conveying what you need mm-hmm. to say, you know, mm-hmm. and making it count. So in a melody, that's what it's all about. You know, in a melody, that's you state your thing and you don't have to say a bunch of notes or a lot of mm-hmm. words or anything like that. It's get the point across with the least amount of words or notes mm-hmm. and make it count. Because, you know, people, Nelson Riddle is one of my favorite arrangers, the late Nelson Riddle, who arranged for Frank Sinatra and mainly. And he had a thing that he said that, you know, when you're playing a lot of notes that, people don't understand because the listener doesn't get all that stuff, and they get pissed off because they can't comprehend what the like Frank Zappa is trying to play. It's frenetic, you know, frantic music. Mm-hmm. People get pissed off because they can't get it, and then you play a simple melody like Moon River, mm-hmm. and then everybody gets it. You know, that's the difference.
It's so eloquently spoken. I got to tell you, I took my family. We were in the Bay Area, so I went to Yoshi's. This is when San Francisco was open. I said, you know, I blog about jazz and stuff. You know, I want to take photos. And they said, okay, this is I'm not going to go over it, but this is a bass player, right, who's fronting a band, straight ahead jazz, right? And they said, okay, you can only take photos for the first three songs. So he starts to play the first song on the bass. I'm thinking, wow, I'm not intelligent enough to figure out where the melody is. So I'm taking pictures. I can't figure out between the first three songs, did I hear three songs or not? Mm-hmm. There was like no melody,
yeah.
Absolutely no melody.
Yeah,
and chops were unbelievable.
Sure.
The crowd was going crazy. I'm thinking either I'm not smart enough or I just love melody.
Well, yeah, that's the thing. You know what, we would have we would play the Bottom Line, this club in New York City,
right.
Do like five nights there, and Jaco would come by,
yeah.
And sit in, and
cool.
We would be playing like What Is Hip, and Rocco would, you know, like
Jaco's the bass player,
Jaco Pastorius,
yeah.
And he would, Rocco would take his strap off and in a little break and hand it to Jaco, he'd get up and play. And, you know, Jaco was like prolific, of course, you know, and rest in peace. But he would come and play with us and he'd just go nuts, you know. But and the crowd would love it. But when Jaco gave back the bass to Rocco and Rocco went back to the bass part that was the established bass line for What Is Hip, the audience went, yeah, that's it, you know, because it was what it was, you know. And so, you know, I say, less is more. You say what you got to say, you get out, you know. I mean, like I just compared it, just like what I said, Henry Mancini's Moon River. I mean, that's...
I don't think wiser words were ever spoken. Yeah. And people get East Bay Soul's albums because there are beautiful, beautiful melodies on there, stuff that you remember. I know when I listen to music, I think, what do I remember? Like jazz bands play a lot of cover tunes. The reason why they play cover tunes is they're great melodies. It's hard to write a great melody, mm-hmm. so people are going to pull out covers because they're great melodies. Summer Horns had great.
Yeah, that's
great
all covers. Tunes. That's all covers.
Right.
Know? I mean, their first one, they did a Tower Power song. They did So Very Hard to Go. It was like I pulled out my old arrangement and dusted it off and here, play it. You know, that was it. You know, so.
Okay, Cheryl, I'm going to have to call an audible here because Pete has to go at 11:15, which I didn't know.
Yes. Oh,
so enough of me. Come
no,
on.
No, we're going to go
no,
back
no,
to you.
We're going to go back to you. Right back to you.
So, okay. So Cheryl.
Yes. Okay.
We have a couple of tunes from his new album. So you have 25 minutes with Pete there.
Oh my goodness! Yeah. I'm so excited. Oh, thank you so much. Good afternoon, Mr. Escovedo. We are so excited to have you here.
Well, I'm excited because. Sitting here with Greg is just, it brings back so many memories. And all the stuff that he's been talking about, man, the Bay Area, that's the place. And we come from there, you know, that's the music that we grew up with and stuff, and the vibe, and just the whole thing of being in the Bay Area is so different. And, you know, me and my brother used to go to the rehearsals when Tower was rehearsing. Because they used to let people come in and just hang out. So it was a hangout thing, you know. We just go, man, we listen to Tower, and we're like, man, it was something. I had black hair then, and I think
Greg
had some hair.
I had hair.
Yeah, we kind of both lost a lot of stuff.
I wish I had your hair.
But, me and my brothers, you know, we would just hang out, man. We'd go. The on Broadway in Oakland, down in the square, yeah, and listen to. And a lot of times, Mimi would ask me, come on up and play a song, you know. Yeah. They had a percussion player at the time, and sometimes, you know, we would just go up there and sit in and play with them. Right. And we just always had a great time. It was so much fun.
Yeah. Well, you first told me when I interviewed you over the phone that you said, well, you know, I was playing around San Francisco, and mm-hmm. then you got your big break. Tell everybody what happened.
Well, you know, I was working a lot just in the Bay Area, me and my brothers. We played like, I don't know, probably every club in the Bay Area, big ones, small ones, and we played so many of them. We closed a lot of them, too. So,
yeah. Pete, is this Latin jazz now? Were you playing?
Well, yeah, we were doing, you know, we started out actually playing dance music, like salsa, you know.
Oh, okay.
We started out doing that. We had a whole trumpet section and everything, and we did that for a while.
And you're on percussion?
Actually, no. I was just playing the guiro and singing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but then we decided to do a smaller group. We had people like Mel Martin on saxophone and some of the guys from the Bay Area. We cut it down to like a little six-piece Latin jazz thing. So we started playing all the jazz clubs then. You know, there was the Matador, Basin Street, Jazz Workshop. And we played all those places, you know, with the smaller group. And so we got into that, and we were working pretty good. And then my brother Coke got a call from Carlos to take Chepito's place.
And who's Carlos?
Yeah, when Chepo Chepito got sick. Well, we were working.
This is the famous Carlos Santana?
Yeah.
Carlos to him.
Yeah, Santana. There's a lot of Carloses in L.A. But, we were playing at a club called the Copa on Broadway. And it was basically a dance club. But they were Carlos and Chepi and Carabella, all the guys, the original band, Shreve and all of them, they were rehearsing at Carlos's mother's house in the back in the garage. And they would come over to the club and listen to us play. So they said, man, after the gig, you guys come over and we're playing, you know, rehearsing at Carlos's mom's place. So we went over there. And, man, we would do this every night after we played our gig. We'd go over.
Well, what time would that be?
You know, 2-3 in the morning. And we would play until daylight.
Wow.
I mean, all of us. And it was so much fun. We were just hanging out. You know, we had no idea how far those guys were going, because they were all kids. They were like you know, 17, 18 years old, you know.
Well, this is Carlos Santana at
that
age?
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah, all the bands and all the guys that were in the band, they were all young. But anyway, later on during the years, Cheffy had gotten sick, so they called, Carlos called Coke to join the band.
That's your brother.
Yeah, take Chepito's place. So they went on tour and stuff, and then I was playing at a, you know, some little dive in the Bay Area with another band. And Coke came in off the road, and, you know, I was glad to see him. He says, yeah, man, you know, just came back from tour with Carlos, and he said, Carlos wants you to join the band because Carabello is not going to make this trip. I said, oh, cool, I would love to, you know. So he said, I told him, well, look, you know, these are the days where you have to get a, you had to give a band 2 weeks' notice before you left, right? So I told the band leader, man, you know, I got to give you 2 weeks' notice. My brother Coke said, no, man, you can't give 2 weeks' notice. We got to leave tomorrow. Uh-huh. So I asked the leader, and he said, man, I'm not going to hold you back from that great opportunity. So we got on the plane to New York. Coke gave me a tape of the show. I had no rehearsal with the band, nothing. I had to learn the show as I listened to the tape. Uh-huh. Got to New York, opened in Madison Square Garden for four straight nights.
Wow.
Not too bad.
So, Pete, had you ever played a venue like that before?
No. I just played all the local places.
And what did that feel like the first time?
Oh, man, I was the seventh heaven. Yeah, right.
Were you nervous at all? Like,
Oh, heck yeah. Heck yeah, I was nervous. But, you know, I kind of followed the band. I kind of knew the songs and stuff, so it was kind of easy to adapt to. And at that time, I was just playing congas because my brother Coke was playing timbales. So, you know, I played with the band there. Then I, you know, stayed with the band for 4 years.
So after you played Madison Garden, did you think this is easy or what?
No, I just thought, well, this is what the next level is. You know, this is what it is to be, you know, a real band traveling, making money, making records and that kind of thing. And, you know, that really started me thinking, hey, you know, I want to do this forever. So when
you almost felt like that when you're playing at 3 a.m. at Carlos's house, right? It was for the love of the music.
It was for the love of the music and fun, and just be around those guys, and they were all great guys, and we had so much fun together. It was really cool. It was like, you know, family. It's like family.
How did you transition? So when you got done playing with Carlos Santana, how did you then transition into your own band?
Well, Coco and I were on the road. You know, we did one trip in Europe, and then when we came back, we were home, and then Cole came over to my house, and he goes, you know what? Since we've been working for somebody else for a while, why don't we start our band again? I said, that would be great. So we decided to start Azteca, which was a pretty large band. So we put that band together. We started out with maybe 8 or 9 people, and then all of a sudden we had about 15, 16 people.
Oh, that's all.
There's a payroll for you.
But when everybody heard that we were starting the band, they all wanted to be in it. So we had, you know, all these guys in the band. And
was it Tom Poole in that band?
Yeah, Tom Poole. Huh? We had all those guys, you know, all those great guys. They were Bob Ferrara, you know, Tom Harrell. We got Lenny White to play drums.
Right.
It was a great band.
Yeah, it was a great band.
So it was just, you know, a great opportunity for us to take that next step, you know, into playing, you know, great music. I think those two albums we did for CBS Columbia are collector's items now.
Ooh,
you
man.
Can you hardly can get them, but it was great because we went on this trip to London with Earth, Wind & Fire, Weather Report, and the Pointer Sisters. We went to London to a CBS convention. This is when Clive Davis was head of CBS, and he's the one that signed all these people. Mm-hmm. So he showcased all of us in London. So we were on the plane, and we were just having a ball with everybody. we got to the hotel in London, the mistake they made was they said, order anything you want. It's free. I'm telling you, there was a bar this big in every room.
Wow.
And we partied for the whole time we were in London. It was fantastic. And this is when Earth, Wind, and Fire with Maurice was there. And that band was...
Wow. Smoke.
Forget about it, man. Yeah. That band was incredible.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. So yeah, it was a tremendous, tremendous experience for us.
And Pete, you also did some work with your daughter back in the late 70s, right?
Well, after we came back.
Well, for our audience, because not everybody knows Pete. Pete's daughter is Sheila E.
Sheila E. Yeah, of course.
The infamous, famous.
Yeah, famous girl.
Yeah. So Pete, could you see when she was little? Did you
know? Oh man, of course.
Yeah. You know, this girl's just got it.
Well, I had a set of congas in my house, and there used to be this commercial. It was Jiffy Peanut Butter. This commercial would come on. She loved this commercial. So she would crawl, she was very, very young, crawl up and watch the TV and hit the drums as the commercial was playing. Wow. I looked at my wife, Juanita, and I said, this girl's going to be something. She's going to be great.
She's awesome.
One thing I have to say about all the Escovedos, Sheila, of course, they're the most dynamic, exciting performers, all of them, Pete included. I remember seeing you guys at Morongo Casino, and you kind of opened up with everybody playing percussion.
Yeah.
It just like for 15 minutes. I don't think there was any other accompaniment but just percussion.
Yeah.
It was amazing, exciting.
Yeah.
Thrilling.
Dynamic.
Can't say enough about Pete Escovedo, Sheila E., Peter Michael, Juan, the whole family, Juanita. No. I've seen her play congas.
Sheila's calling in right now.
Oh.
Let's see. I think she's going to
check it out.
Okay.
So anyway.
But you were talking about playing with her.
Well, after a while, when we had the Azteca band, and as much as we loved that band, we just never made any money. We'd go on the road, come back from the road, owing more than what we made.
Welcome to the club.
I know you were going to say that. You know how that is.
And, it just got to be at a point where we just, it was...
Pete, you probably had to drop from 15 pieces to six, right?
Trying to ride a dead horse doesn't, you don't get anywhere, so... I just decided to give it up, and I kind of said, I'm going to go on my own. But at the same time, I saw that my daughter Sheila was really playing great, so I got her in the band. And so we did Pete and Sheila Escovedo, two albums with Billy Cobham. Billy Cobham producing.
Right.
And that was a whole other experience for us because it taught us. I knew of one way to play music, but then... Playing with Billy took me to another level because
for our audience show, can you explain
Billy,
to me?
Well, Billy Common, very famous jazz drummer back.
Billy to me is the greatest drummer in the world. I have to say that because the boy is incredible, and he, he's one of those guys that just takes chances all the time. There's no rules to what he does, and he actually taught us how to play in a whole different kind of time signatures. Because he would do that. You would start out in a 4-4 rhythm, and then all of a sudden he'd go into 12 something or whatever. he just takes it wherever. So,
is he a left-handed player?
No, he's equally handed.
Okay.
But he had these great guys in there. George Duke.
George Duke.
Yeah, no, John Scofield. I had all these guys that we were recording with. And Sheila and I were like, man, here we are with these guys at CBS recording. And it was just such a great experience to know him. And so that's when we were doing his album. And then he said, what are you guys doing? I said, well, we're not doing much at Planet Clubs. He says, well, I can get you a record deal at Fantasy. So he produced the next two records for us. But at the time, when Sheila had met George Duke was putting his band together, And so he asked Sheila to go on the road and join him. So I told her, yeah, go, man. That's a great opportunity to go play with George Duke. So she went with George. And so I decided just go ahead and start my Latin jazz band up and never look back.
Never looked back.
And that was Grammy nominated, right, for Mr. E? You were Grammy nominated?
Yeah, I got a... well, you know, I've always been very close to Tito Puente. He's one of my greatest friends.
Yeah, good friend.
And so he was recording for Concord. And so I went over to one of the sessions. He invited me to come over and listen to one of his recordings. I was over there with Carl Jefferson, who at the time was the owner of Concord Records. And he asked me, what are you doing? I said, I'm just, you know, have my band and playing. He goes, come on into the office tomorrow and come and see me. So I went in, and I had actually did my own record, Yesterday's Memories, Tomorrow's Dreams. I did a live album at Mills College in Oakland. So I took that over to him, and he really liked it. So he said, let's work a deal. He said, I'll distribute it and put it under our label. I said, cool. I said, as long as I get the money back, what I paid to do this. So he did that. He paid me off.
Those were the good old days, right?
Those were good days.
Yeah.
You can walk into those places. Can't do it anymore. So he took that album, and then he signed me to a deal with Concord, and then I did all those other CDs with Concord. Yeah.
And now we have a new CD out. Yeah. Let's tell everybody about you. And you have a new hip, cool video out, too. So.
Got a hip video out.
You have to check out this video.
Oh, it is so fabulous.
Pete is beyond cool in this video.
I know.
Well, it's my first video at 83 years old.
You do a great job.
You know what? Talk about what is hip. This guy is hip.
So I look at myself as an overnight success.
Oh, that's all he is. But it's from your new CD called Back to the Bay.
Tell
everybody about your new CD.
Well, we went back to the Bay. That's, you know, that's my home. That's I love the Bay Area. But my son, Peter Michael, was really responsible for the whole thing because I kept kicking around, what in the world am I going to do this time? You don't know what to do next, you know. I mean, you want to be true to your fans, you know. You definitely want to be true to your fans and the people that support you. You know what you do with the kind of music you play. Uh-huh. And basically, what I do is Latin jazz. But
But
my son Peter Michael said, let's do something different, you know. So what we did is we went back and listened to a lot of old school songs back in the day that remind us of Oakland. It's so many great songs, it was so hard to pick which ones we were going to do. But the idea was to take these songs that people know and put the Latin jazz stuff on it.
Such a good
and it works.
Phenomenal idea.
Yeah.
And we happen to have a copy of it.
This is it. Back
Can't
to the
to
Bay,
hear.
Right here. You can get it. Yeah. Where can we all get it?
Well, you get on Amazon.com, and I sell them at all my gigs.
Is this you?
Yeah, this is
what I this is so cute. This is
I was
a picture.
I was
oh,
18.
My God.
I was 18.
Oh, well, look how handsome. He was handsome back then, too. So
yeah, I look like Paul Anka right
You
there.
Do a little bit like Paul Anka. So what the music video is, what song are you doing?
Let's Stay Together.
Let's Stay Together.
Yeah, the Cy Smith.
We have that tune.
We have that tune. Right. We're going to play that.
That's a great video.
You know, I'm going to play it when Pete makes his exit because that we have still 9 minutes.
Right? Yeah.
Okay, so Back to the Bay, and we also have What You Won't Do for Love in the Stone.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, we took Earth, Wind, and Fire song. We did Bobby Caldwell was kind enough to, you know, sing the song again.
Really?
Wow, really?
He's singing this song?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
In the Stone.
Oh, cool.
No, he sings.
Oh, I'm sorry.
One.
Yeah.
Okay.
His hit.
Yeah, his hit.
Oh, yeah. Very good. Excellent.
So he was real cool about it, you know, to do it kind of Latin-wise.
Uh-huh.
Usually. Mm.
And we are going to hear this at the Oxnard Jazz Festival.
Oh,
right?
So, Chuck, this album is party certified.
It's party certified.
Back to the Bay.
Bring your dancing shoes.
Oh, my goodness.
So get ready to party up in here.
Oh, yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun. Just share the stage with all these great musicians.
This guy has such incredible energy. 83 years old. Oh. He can still knock it out of the park.
83 yeah. young,
that's
we say.
That's because he's doing what he loves.
Uh-huh. Yep. Oh, yeah. Yeah, 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 I love it. Yeah, I'll just keep going until
Petey,
I can't do it
anymore.
Are
you still singing, buddy?
A little bit. I do some singing, but, you know, I'm the worst critic about my voice. Oh. I always think
I saw him about 3 years ago on the Dave Cause cruise when he was a youngin', about 80 probably, and he did a Frank Sinatra song. It was killer.
Oh.
Yeah, everybody that, loved yeah. it.
Yeah, Dave Cause, by the way, is my only Jewish son. That
oh,
I've
there you go.
Can I be your Jewish daughter?
Jewish co-host.
Jewish
co-host.
Pete, I want to ask you, you know, you've been in the business for so long now. Can you just talk to the young musicians out there? Boy, has the music industry changed since you started back
oh
in the
boy.
Late 60s, and great, too.
Is there
it's
an industry?
Great. No. Well, let's know. Even talk about that. You know, it's really
weeks.
Important because we still want to hear our, we love the live music. I want to buy a CD. So
well, I want to hear, Pete, what advice
yes.
would you give young people who want to get to where you're at right now?
Well, I think if it's their passion, they really love it. It's a lot of sacrifices. It's
yes.
Up and down business. It's, you know, for all of us, you know, and I don't care if you're at the top, it's still
right.
up and down business. You never know what's going to happen from year to year, you know. It's tough being on the road. It's a lot of sacrifices for your family, if you have a family. And so you have to really make up your mind, well, this is really what I really love. It's got to be your passion. It's got to be your love for the music. And, you know, just learn your craft as much as you can. Whatever instrument it is, learn it. Learn it to the full extent. And try to be as professional as you can, because you get called to go into a studio, be prepared, be a professional. Show up on time, you know.
By the way, Pete was 15 minutes early today. So.
Yeah.
I'm always
right.
early.
Yeah,
yeah. I like yeah. being early. But, yeah, I always tell the kids, you know, make sure, you know, you do what the leader of the band wants you to do. It's not your band. You do what
mm-hmm.
he wants you to do. And don't try to outshine everybody else. When it comes time for you to play, if he gives you a solo, then that's when you shine. But otherwise, play with the band. Listen, keep your ears open. Play with everybody. You know.
You know, Pete. You know, and you know, yeah. you know, Pete. It's like, how do you get to Carnegie Hall? Practice.
And
right.
it's not easy. I mean, I interview a lot of musicians, and the kids now think, oh, I could become a big star and then go viral. No, that's not what the passion, the
you
artistry
have to really,
is about. You have
you
to
have
practice.
To really have something that you want to give.
Absolutely.
And be passionate about giving it.
Music is not a haircut.
It is not.
Right. Yeah,
and look at these two gentlemen. I mean, they've been in the business for so long, and they don't take it for granted at all, and they still are, you know, you practice, and like you said.
Well, we've lasted the test of time, right?
You certainly have.
Pete, I have another question for you. You
sure.
always look immaculate.
Thank you.
And you and I had a conversation back in Spagatini about 9 years ago
mm-hmm.
about you always dressed impeccably. You want to tell us about, like, this goes back to the early days, right?
Yeah,
like junior high school. Even.
Well, I was in school, yeah, and I met a guy had just moved there from New York, and we became friends. And he would always come dressed to school. And I always asked him, I said, man, you know, how come you're always really dressed? He goes, well, you know, I come from New York, and, you know, I used to listen to jazz and stuff, and every time I go hear jazz, and this is back in the bebop era, right? So he goes, all those guys, man, they wear suits and ties and they look really cool. So I told him, well, man, you know, I want to be a musician too. And he goes, well, if you're going to be a musician, you better dress up, man. Go get a suit. So I went and bought me a suit.
And you how old then? Maybe?
I went to school in a suit and tie and playing music. And that's one thing about my band is, the first thing they have to have is a suit and a tie. So they got to look presentable.
This is class right here.
I always tell them, no jeans and no tennis shoes, man. You know, you're playing music, you got to look up. People are looking at you.
Right.
Don't come up there all raggedy, you know, wear a suit.
And so did your classmates, did they ask you, hey, Pete, why are you doing this?
Oh, yeah, they thought I was crazy. But that's cool, you know, you do what you love to do. You know, I love dressing up and... Mm-hmm. course, my wife gets mad every time I bring you home a new suit. But,
Yes.
She said, if you bring another suit home, I'm going to leave you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I said, man, I'm going to miss her.
Okay, so on that note, I'm going to miss her. We're going to play.
She's pointing her finger.
We're going to play a song called Let's Stay Together, because somehow you guys figured it out, right?
Yeah, we should.
So you've been standing up. So you want to set up this tune for us, Pete, off of your new CD, Back to the Bay, right?
Yeah, this is the Al Green song. I'm so fortunate to have Cy Smith on this.
She's so great.
Yeah. She's incredible, yeah. Man. She did such a great job for us, and she's just so wonderful, a great person, and so talented. So
beautiful.
She did this song, and my son Peter Michael directed the video.
Oh, wait. So we're going to play Let's Stay Together, though, because Yeah,
let's stay together.
All right, let's go.
Since we've been together, loving you forever is what I need. Let me be the one you come running to. People break up, they turn around and make up, yes they do, but I just can't see, no, you never do that to me, but you baby, cause being around you, that's all.
happy or sad.
Oh my goodness.
I love
what
that.
A great song. Oh my goodness.
Great tune. So again, the CD is Back to the Bay. It's a new CD by Pete Escovedo and his band. That song was featuring Cy Smith. Let's Get Together. What they did show, correct me if I'm wrong, is they took some classic tunes and remade them in a Latin jazz style. It's great.
It changes the whole character when you put
really
a Latin
does.
Vibe on it.
Oh, yeah.
And that upright bass on that last song,
But, you know, a good song is a good song.
Yes. It is.
You know.
Yes. You guys do that song, don't you?
Yes, we do. And as a matter of fact, I was saying earlier that we just played Seattle for two nights at Jazz Alley, and we had a 90-minute-plus show, and one of the new things on our CD, I'm not trying to take the spotlight
No.
Oh, please. You know, spotlight is on you, Greg.
What we do, we found that, you know, we develop a cover song and then we play it for a couple of years, and then we're sitting at the CD table after the show signing, and they say, well, what CD is this one on? And that one, and so, well, we hadn't recorded it yet. Mm. So we figured out, well, we better record this. So, we did.
So which tunes were those?
Let's Stay Together.
And I would always thought that was on one of your
and
CDs.
And then we did.
It is.
We did also.
Now.
Yeah. Years ago, I did. I was an arranger for Luis Evandros, and I did the songs album, and we did Going in Circles, and so we were thinking of covers, and I thought, well, you know, Daryl, what's a good key for this? And you know, and it was the same key. So we just I kind of pulled the arrangement out, and we recorded that on the last record too. So Let's Stay Together.
That's on Conversations.
No.
Oh,
the
on
2.0.
That's Life.
Oh, That's Life.
Yeah. So I figured, well, we're kind of winning this battle. Let's figure out another cover to do. You know, we're not a cover band, but you know, this a classic song is a classic song.
It is.
So
yeah.
Andrea.
But
and
it takes on a new life, though. When you do it, it takes on a new life.
Yeah, but you know, and when you do a cover, you try to at least come up to the original. Maybe you can make it a little better, but you know, do it justice. You know. Mm-hmm. So, Andrea and I were sitting around, and Andrea, my wife, is the executive producer on this record and the new one, Conversations, and. What could we do? What could we really? What would be a good one? And so she said, "What's that one? Sitting on the dock on the bay, right?" And I said, "Yeah, that's a good one." You know. So we listened to it. And it's only like a minute and a half long.
Are you serious?
And so I said, "There's another one. There's another one." And then she said, "How about Try a Little Tenderness?" And so I said, "Yeah." And
who did that song originally?
Otis Redding.
And that song was written.
That's
a
great song.
It was written by a couple of Brits in the '30s.
Really,
it's a very old song, and And he, Otis didn't want to sing it. He kind of went, you know, he just was not into it. But Cropper, you know, Steve Cropper and Booker T and the MGs, they were the band on that. And the Memphis Horns were on in the horn section when they recorded that. And they recorded it live. And it was just turned out to be one of his biggest songs. So I said, okay, let's do this one. You know, so we, that's how we've been ending our show. And,
it's amazing.
You know, it's after 90 minutes, and then we do that. I rearranged the horn section open. It's like three horns, the Memphis Horns. It's Wayne and Andrew and Jack. And it's real simple, but I kind of took it with five horns and made it a real contemporary kind of a da 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 ba ba. We kind of make it real clustery and all kind of feathery and, you know, fancy. And then all of a sudden, boom, Daryl comes in. And so it builds and it builds and it builds and it builds. And then all of a sudden, man, it's a freight train out of control. It just is rolling downhill in tracks. And so we finish. That's it. Thank you. Good night. And we walk off stage, and the crowd is like, you're not done yet. So, and we had eliminated Let's Stay Together from the show because we, you know, can only do so many covers. And then we come back on stage, and it goes, ba, da, 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 and the crowd goes, oh.
They went off.
Yeah, it was off the tracks.
I have to say, I saw them play at Bogies, right. And I saw them perform that song, and it is such killer. You are just like overwhelmed. It's so amazing. And Daryl's voice, and Daryl knows this, I love his voice. Oh my goodness.
Yeah. Thank you.
Just rips so, yeah, into so you. I. The horns rip into you. His voice rips into you, and you're just like, oh, right.
So if you guys want to see this freight train out of control.
Yeah.
You're gonna have to go to the party,
the Oxnard
Jazz Festival.
Now, Chuck, you're gonna have to give us a few more minutes on the stage.
Oh, though. Yeah. Oh yeah. There you go. I'm seeing it.
And guess what? We're gonna have another. You can win a pair of tickets to this fabulous September 8th. This is after Labor Day. So you can be there, but you can win another set of lawn tickets because Chuck has brought in two pairs. We already had one winner. So we have another question to our listening audience. If you have not been listening, you might not know the answer to this question, but we just interviewed, right, Pete Escovedo.
Yes, and Pete Escovedo talked about his first big break
with a
famous band and band member. What was the name of the band that gave Pete Escovedo his first break?
And he played with for 4 years from the Bay Area. Tell us, let Mikey Adam Smith, our social influencer here, know the answer, and you too can have a pair of these tickets to the Oxnard Jazz Festival.
And Cheryl, another thing for our audience, we looked a little bit, shall we say, disorganized during Pete Escovedo.
I
mean, unbeknownst to us, had to leave at 11:15.
Yeah.
So we had to call an audible and switch over when we. Greg, my apologies when we were interviewing you.
Oh, we have a winner.
Yeah.
It's Tom Huna, Carlos Santana. That was
Tom Huna.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yes, we want the Huna family to come to Oxnard.
Is that Chase's
congratulations.
Dad?
Yep. That's Chase's Chase Huna's father. Thank you, Tom.
So, Chuck, you can have an opening act and free ticket. Chase Huna.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So, congratulations, Tom Huna. Anyway, what I was referring to is Pete had to leave, and so we were just rearranging course. Greg wants to say goodbye to him. Andrew wants to say goodbye to him. So everybody was going a different direction. So here we are. We're resetting it. Greg Adams is our guest.
We have reconvened.
Greg Adams, Daryl Walker, of now East Bay Soul, Chuck Dennis, promoter of Oxnard Jazz Festival, Cheryl Aronson, our guest co-host, doing a great job,
Thank
Cheryl.
Thank you.
Very proud of you.
And our social media concierge, the one and only Mikey Adam Cohen.
That's
and
a good title.
Social media, I know. Yeah.
Social media concierge. Yeah. That's good.
So to define social media concierge, since that title didn't exist previous to that, because we go on social media, we thought it might be cool to have somebody who's personable interact with the people that are coming on the show and making comments. So anybody that comes in, and makes a comment, Mike will address him. Or if he even sees that they're watching, he will address them. So we make it upfront and personal. And it's kind of like a little chat room going on during the show. So thank everyone for tuning in on Facebook Live and on LA Talk Radio.
And in case you want to know where you are, we are Inside the Music with Will Donato and Jack Cohn.
Yeah,
at our home here in Sherman Oaks at LA Talk Radio.
Yes.
Okay, there we go. So Greg, let's talk about your new CD.
Yeah, okay. You know, let me just, before we go, you know, East Bay Soul has been...
We should...
8 years now?
Yeah, we should talk about that.
No, almost 10.
Almost 10.
Wow.
And it was started out, it was kind of funny. I'd been a solo artist and had a 7-piece band and this and that. And then we kind of came to a point where we needed to do something different. And I wanted to go back to my core roots, which was a large band, you know, and when I left Tower Power, I took my sound with me, and that was the sound of the horn section, and they have been looking for me, a new me, for many years. But I wanted to do something with the, we were an instrumental band, I wanted to do a singer, so we came up with this idea called East Bay Soul, and so it took a while, and we started out with was it Phil or Lenny? First?
Lenny, right?
Lenny. Lenny Williams, the former lead singer for Tower Power. Mm. I thought, well, we can do, my instrumental stuff. We can maybe do some Tower Power covers, which I was not too thrilled about. But you have Lenny Williams singing, you know. Okay, cool. That did not work out whatsoever. It was a disaster. Mm. So then we got Phil Perry.
Him.
Yeah,
I had no idea.
And Tom Scott was the lead tenor player in the band, and that we toured that for about 2 weeks. Mm.
2 weeks.
And that was crazy. We were in minivans getting lost on the East Coast, and we played a Blues Alley in D.C.
Mm.
And on the strength of Phil Perry and Tom Scott and my name, the club owner paid us an exorbitant amount of money for that dump, and nobody came.
Wow.
Nobody came to the show. And the clash of personalities is, once again, it didn't work out with Lenny, it didn't work out with Phil, it didn't work out with Tom, and we were like just Sean Holt, a local singer and saxophonist here in the area, who knows everybody. I said, Sean, can you give me any list of singers? And he gave me like 7 guys, and their demos, and each one sounded like they were more suitable to be singing with Lynyrd Skynyrd than with East Bay Soul. And on the bottom was this guy, Daryl Walker. And his demo reel was covers, because he was in a did a lot of corporate work and stuff like that at that time, and this was 9 years ago.
Mm.
So, on the strength of that demo, I asked him to come up to the studio. We were doing the first East Bay Soul record, and I gave him one song to sing, and it was
I Hope.
I Hope.
Yeah, I Hope.
And he comes in the studio, and Andrea and I and Carmen Grillo, the engineer, mm-hmm. were sitting in the booth. And I'm going to cue you on this right now. He goes in the studio, stands in front of the mic, and Carmen says, well, let's get some sound. So do the
do, yeah.
And the three of us in the booth go, oh my God!
I would too.
Holy shit! You know. So anyway, so that was it, and that was the beginning I'd had it with singers. I mean, the third sex. You know what I mean? And so, I had Tom Bowes from Tower Power. He sang a couple songs. Sean Holt sang "Jump, Shout, and Holler," and mm-hmm. Daryl sang one song on the record. And I was damned, I'm not going to get taken advantage of any more singers, man. I'm going to have 4 guys I can call. Well, this guy doesn't work out. This guy's gone. I'm going to call this guy. So Daryl just the cream rose to the top. And so anyway, Daryl's been with the band and literally one of the best singers in the business.
He does a killer jump shot too.
Yeah. And so you know, it's kind of funny. And Possibilities is the last single it did pretty good at radio, Lookbook. And now we're looking at a new sing, and you know, in our genre, it's instrumental. But now our radio promotion people, the Gorovs, they're looking at Quiet Scream, which is a vocal cut off the new record. And it's a very poignant song that I wrote several years ago with Billy Kent. And it addresses child abuse. And it's a killer song. And we did it with Tower Power years ago. But it didn't see the light of the day because Doc and Mimi didn't write it. You know, they get the attention. You know, I'm mainly a B-side, as they call it, you know. No offense, but, you know, so there's been a couple of songs that I've re-recorded that I did with Tower Power, and Daryl has sang. Mm-hmm. And so this one is Quiet Scream, and we're considering that as a next single, which is rare because it's a vocal.
It's been that, okay, you can't put a vocal out in contemporary jazz, but a lot of vocalists have hung out there and done pretty well.
Yeah, that's right.
Lindsay Webster has had, like, I don't know how many number ones, two or three number ones.
Sure.
Top 10. And if you're really good and it's good music, you can hang out in contemporary jazz. Right.
And the genre has morphed into so many different things. There are no rules anymore. You can't.
Correct.
Because what has happened is it's kind of cannibalized itself because of the narrow-mindedness of so many people that are running the game, that hey, what do we got to lose, for crying out loud?
Well, you know, and I think that now, because there's barriers to entry in R&B and other genres, because radio promotion's so expensive, that you have a lot of talented people and cool people hanging out. And so when we go to a jazz festival, we can see a variety of people that are extremely talented and putting out great music. It's all about great music. Mm-hmm. If you have great music, you can hang out in contemporary jazz and people will like it.
Yeah. I mean, I'm known as a jazz instrumentalist, but I have an orchestra with a vocalist. Right. And it runs the gamut of all styles and everything.
I want to do a shout out though to Daryl's vocals, because Daryl not only has an amazing, soulful, sexy, sultry voice. This man can scat.
Yeah,
he knows
and plays tenor saxophone.
Yeah,
and to play tenor sax and knows his jazz definitely. So Greg Adams, of course, is amazing arranger, composer of all these songs, and Daryl sings it with such heart and soul. Mm-hmm. And it's again,
you
come see them at the Oxnard Jazz Festival, you will be loving this band.
We're gonna light it up.
You'll be wowed in your seat, and you'll also party.
It's just amazing. To
piggyback on what you were saying, when you have as a vocalist, and when this goes back also to the less is more frame of mind, when you have a bed, so to speak, of such lush, incredible sounds and space, you know, Greg arranges with space. You can really enjoy the tune because the melody's not obscured. There's space in there to really appreciate what's going on. That's where I get the less is more attitude. I really love that way of thinking because I apply that in everything I do, in every project I'm associated with. I don't like to sing too much. I don't like there to be 10,000 notes from bar one to the end of the song, because everything gets lost. It's just a bunch of gymnastics. I like, you know, when you tell a story and you emote and you give everything you have from your soul in that way of thinking of less being more, that's what grabs people.
Sure.
You know, because
you reach more people.
You do. I mean, think about it. People like to sing in the shower, in the car, wherever they are. You know, they do it to the songs that are memorable, that are simple. They don't try to do the gymnastics because they can't, you know.
Well, then again, it's back to that melody and emoting that melody to the audience. And nobody does it better than this guy.
Nobody does it better than this guy.
I just love it. That's all it is. It's just
and again, come to the Oxnard Jazz Festival and you'll hear it. So why don't we focus on the new album for for a few minutes, then these guys will perform live, and then we're out.
All right. Oh, I'm so excited.
So, for those who are just listening, it's called Conversations?
Conversation. No, Conversation.
Singular.
Conversation.
Oh, Conversation. Conversation. Yes. Sorry. Conversation.
Yeah, and we did it. It's kind of funny. We went to a new studio. We had a new engineer. And not to say anything about where we've done our last few records at, but the band needed a change. And sometimes change is good. Most of the time, change is good. You know, it was for the better, and the band really blossomed on this. We've done our records in a home studio, where it's just everybody's kind of crammed in a one room, and the drums are in one room, and you know, it's just, this time we did it at Clear Lake in North Hollywood, and
nice place,
big room, and the rhythm section was in the same room at the same time, and it made the difference of a night and day, and the band clicked. I mean, the spontaneity and the chemistry was just relit. I mean, like it was a new candle.
Greg, from when you wrote or put the arrangements together originally, have these songs morphed at all when you're in the studio?
Well, you know, we rehearse before we go into the studio because it's cheaper to rehearse than rehearse in a rehearsal hall than it is to rehearse in the studio.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of funny. When I do the arrangements for the rhythm, I do them in my own hand. And then I make copies of it and hand it out. And that's how it kind of grows. I mean, I have my direction that I want it to go for the song. And we, you know, it's a multi-step program where you record the rhythm tracks first, and then we add the horns.
For our audience, rhythm tracks, keys,
guitar, bass, drums, and then horns and strings. Then after all that is on there, then Daryl comes in, and he's got this orchestra to sing to.
Mm-hmm.
So, and this one we used a lot of strings on this one, anyway. It all kind of grows, you know. I mean, I'm not a strict guy. I mean, I have my concept, but I want the guys in the rhythm section to contribute, you know. That's why it's such a great band, because everybody in the band's a great player, but it's the bed that we build from the bottom up, and so, you know, sometimes what Keita's doing is, I don't think so. That's back off on that. Just do this, you know, do this part. And the bass line might be a little complicated. Let's simplify it, you know. Herman Matthews on drums, you can't tell him what to do. He knows what he's doing. he lays it down. And then he's like the groove master of doom, you know. I say on stage, back there driving the bus, you know, on drums, Herman Matthews. So,
that's
and
it.
Smitty on bass, who... is just, you know, he's great. And Nick Milo, and I was saying earlier, he came from Joe's band, and he and I have been known each other for decades. And, you know, he lifted the band musically to a new level. From the day he came in, everybody went, whoa. I mean, everybody just, it was amazing, the change in the band, the level of musicianship.
So sometimes change is good.
Oh, it was in this and that. Yeah. So we go in, we lay the rhythm tracks down, and I said, as I said, I do it in my own hand because I don't want to pay a copyist, you know, who I have a copyist I've worked with for 35 years. He's my guy. And so I don't want to, if there's changes to be made and you're scratching out stuff and by the time you get finished, it's a mess on paper. So we lay down the rhythm checks, then I go back and I know what I want the horns to do, but now I have the track, the real track, the rhythm track. And now I do the horns and the strings and then I get it to my copyist because I know this is going to be what it's going to be. Aww. And then we put the horns on, the strings on, and it's amazing. The engineer, Kenji Nakai, I use a string quartet, you know, but what we do is
You have live strings?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. No,
I didn't know that either.
And what we do is, because Clear Lake is such a big room, we have four spots, four groups of four chairs, here, there, and here. And the mics are all overhead, and there's no close miking. You're using the room to make the sound. So we do first pass on the strings, then we move the strings over to these chairs, and we do the second pass, and then we move the strings over here, and we do the third pass, and then we move them over here.
And you try to see which acoustically sounds better?
No. All of a sudden, we have 16 strings.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
and then we have them change bows, and different bows make a different sound.
Oh,
so it sounds like another player.
Wow.
So you got an orchestra. All
like Greg Adams Orchestra.
Yeah, so
that's great.
Is this a good, the contribution of the engineer or
yeah, that's Kenji's idea, and we did it.
That's
on we did it on a project. Kenji was the engineer. Now, how I met Kenji was we did a project with Daryl's significant other, girlfriend, April, and she's a singer. And so
Daryl, you never told us that.
Kenji did this in a smaller
time.
Yeah. And so we did this in another project. And so I said, Kenji, let's do this again.
That is you a know, great
so
idea.
And it's gorgeous. And my concert mistress is a former Miss Iowa. So she looks good going in. And and she's got a great group of gals who just play their butts off. And they're all like, they play on the America's Got Talent, or you know the shows that have the live bands, you know the dance, you know
Dancing with the Stars.
Yeah, they're all the gals who sit in the front row, or you know because they look good doing it, you know. So anyway, it's great, and they're great players, and so that's how we kind of build it. And by like I said, by the time we get Daryl in there, he's got a full band.
We want to hear Daryl sing.
Yeah,
and Greg play, right?
Okay, it's about that time,
yeah,
guys.
I think it is.
It's almost noon. I think I can play.
Okay, I think his lip is
we're
okay.
Warm now.
So off the new album, right?
Yes, this one is "Our Love Divine." It was written by Rocky Moffatt, who is a friend of Nick Milo's. He lives in Illinois, and he is a very talented lyricist. I mean, this is one of those songs where you got to listen to it a few times to get the lyric, because it's amazing, the romantic lyric that he wrote for this song. It's called "Our Love Divine."
Mm. Okay, we can't wait to hear it. So you guys get ready, and then we're gonna do it right now.
All right. So if you're just listening to us now, this is going to be performed also at the Oxnard Jazz Festival.
Oh, yeah.
And we can't wait to hear it live in studio. Take it away, guys.
This is our love divine. I don't wanna stop. Oh no, no. I know we're supposed to go where I don't wanna know. Can't we stay in tonight? We're never gonna find what I have in mind unless we turn up the lights. So let's turn up the lights. Yeah.
We felt goosebumps. So, if you're going to be in the crowd at Oxnard, be prepared.
So this is a song you wrote with Milo?
No, this was written by Rocky Moffat.
And God bless him.
That's a killer too.
That's a killer.
When he gave it to us, I broke it down to the bare bones, and
so
that's
great.
You know,
less is more.
Oh man, you know, and I knew when we were just doing the rhythm,
brilliant.
I looked forward and forward and forward. Mm. I knew what the strings were going to do, and I knew what the horns, and it's just, there's nothing there. It's just the song, you know, and it carries its own self. And, well, you just heard it. Daryl nailed it.
Beautiful.
Oh, no. Wonderful.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
So I want to thank everybody for tuning in. I want to thank Greg Adams for coming down, and I want to thank Chuck Dennis for the
Oxnard.
Now, how can you get tickets for Oxnard Jazz Festival?
Okay, he wants. Okay, so everybody.
Well, let's not forget Daryl.
No, we're not done.
No, but we have stopped just for a moment. Okay, the Oxnard Jazz Festival will be September 8th. Right now, you can go to www.oxnardjazzfestival.com. Get your lawn seats, get your VIP, come join us. You're going to hear these fabulous East Bay Soul, Pete Escovedo, Mindy Hebert, Confunction, Tierra, Kelly's Lot, Paul Brown. Did I miss anybody? Rick Parma, of course. You are going to so enjoy yourself because Oxnard is a beautiful community. It isn't super crowded. It isn't like Long Beach, which is a great jazz festival. You will be loving Oxnard. It's by the beach, Greg said.
Yes.
It's Mala without the boo. And we have hotels, right, Chuck?
Yes,
that
we
will
do.
Be giving discounts, and that's all on our Facebook.
Website.
What's the Facebook? Is also Oxnard Jazz Festival.
Sure.
Yeah, okay.
And we have
sure.
a limited number of VIPs left. So once again, if you want to sit right up close and personal and right by the dance floor, make sure you get that soon. And
Greg, how do our audience get your music? What's your website?
GregAdamsMusic.com.
All right, there we go.
EastBaySoul.com.
And Daryl, where do they find your music?
DarylFWalker.com. And we'll be dropping a new single to you guys pretty soon.
All right.
Oh, by the way, this guy has killer solo projects as well, too. I just saw him do a tribute to Al Jarreau.
Al Jarreau, what a show.
If there's anybody
stunning.
Who can do it.
Yes. Stunning. I mean, stunning. Nice. Yeah, at the Mediterranean.
And that was a big band, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so thank you
to the club.
Thank you to Pete Escovedo.
Pete Escovedo, what a legend we had here today, yeah. Jack. He was lovely.
You know, it's funny because Pete and I have known each other for decades. And, you know, when he left and I... There was a club that was a Latin club in the Mission District on near Army Street, near the Armory in San Francisco. I couldn't remember the name. I said, what's the name of that club? That club, you know, out there in the Mission. He said, Caesars. I said, yes, Caesars.
And 83 years old and still got it.
Yeah, and, you know, it's funny because at Tower Power in those days, we were always looking for clubs to play, you know, and that was a big club. You know, it was a large, you know, capacity club. We thought, well, it's good. And I remember Pete saying to me, no, you guys don't want to play there. Because we weren't a Latin band. That was strict Latin.
Oh.
I mean, you know, zoot suits and stuff like that. You know, so anyway, Pete and I go back and Coke, rest in peace, his brother. I mean, so many stories. Like you said, they come to our rehearsals and stuff. Man, he's a legend.
He is a legend.
So thank you again, Pete Escovedo.
Yeah.
Everybody, our next show, tune in July 28th, it'll be Phil Denny.
Oh,
yeah, Phil Denny.
From the Midwest.
Yeah, so a lot of ladies will be tuning into that show. And thanks so much, everybody, for tuning in. Have a great weekend. Remember, tomorrow night at the Mediterranean Jazz and Supper Club, we have Nils, and we have Billboard number one for 3 weeks, Jeff Ryan. So everybody, hope to see you in San Diego tomorrow. For tickets, What's Up Dago. .com. Bye,
That's
everybody.
That's D-A-Y-G-L-R. Bye-bye.
It's Inside the Music with saxophonist Will Donato and co-host Jack Cohen. We bring you renowned recording artists and musical guests from around the globe, featuring live in-studio performances from our very special guests. We broadcast live from the LA Talk Radio studios the first and third Saturdays of each month in stunning HD video. Thank you for tuning in to Inside the Music.